Unapologetic by Francis Spufford is a book that was published earlier this year in England, and it's just out now from HarperCollins here. The Dark Path by David Schickler was published about 6 weeks ago by Riverhead Books. And the two books have plenty in common. I noticed especially the comedy of the books. They're not altogether comic, but the willingness to take the comic path to serious stuff is really striking and a tonic in certain times, but it seems natural now. A year ago, we had Cardinal Dolan from New York in conversation with Stephen Colbert. Now we have a Pope who can take a joke, apparently. And so one more reason why it's a good moment to be together with these two authors. Do you mind if I just I could launch right in, or your bios are on the books, I think, but Francis Spufford is a writer who was brought to my attention several years ago when I was working in publishing, because he had published a book called Red Plenty, having to do with the Soviet Union. He can tell you a little bit about it. But the publisher I was working for was a weird publisher, so it was already loaded up with books about the Soviet Union, this 20 years after the Soviet Union was ended. So we stood aside. So there I was suddenly in London, over Holy Week, with lots of Christian stuff like Passions and Messiahs, and there's a book in the LRB bookshop, and it's this book, and I buy it, and I read it, and I go from being surprised that such a book exists to feeling that such a book was not only necessary but inevitable, and that it was inevitable that it should come from this author, Francis Spufford. Is that, I told you I'd ask you one question, then let you take it away and read. But my question is, to read the book, it's an account. As a former publisher, I have a thing about subtitles and how fake they usually are. But this is one you must have come up with yourself, because it's pretty good.
I have. Hi, by the way, can you hear me, or am I amplified, or no? I'm all right. Okay. I did come up with it myself, but as the result of a long, long afternoon with my editor. I have a notebook page containing 27 variants of that subtitle as we tried to explain what the book was from a standing start on one page. That's among the shorter versions.
Faulkner wanted The Sound and the Fury to be printed in 27 different colors of ink. To capture all the different streams of consciousness. So that's kind of what, there are 27 different ways you could have represented this book. But he came up with, in case you haven't seen it, Why Despite Everything, Christianity Can Still Make Surprising Emotional Sense. And we could turn the biblical exegetes on that and have them just examine every word of it and what it suggests. But it is yours.
It is mine. Despite Everything had to be there because the book is, I mean, I hope it'll travel, but the book is written for the European situation, where people are very conscious of the despite everything part, where it comes to religion, but tend to stop there and never even hear the positive case for it. So I had to begin where people are. With a sense of religion as antique and embarrassing and far from serving any real human need, simply representing something at best historical, at worst oppressive. And one of the things I had to address was people's sense of Christian history as nothing but a tissue of bloodshed and bigotry and various kinds of, I wouldn't even say falling short, because falling short would imply there was something worthwhile to fall short of. So the book had to contain, and it had to contain a number of ridiculously self-sufficient things. It had to contain a complete portable version of the New Testament story for people who hadn't heard it. It had to contain an account of Christian history, all of it, which would
20 pages.
Oh yes, I move fast, ladies and gentlemen. Which would not sidestep people's sense that it was a record of horror and nastiness, but talk about why nevertheless we persist with it. And the bit I'm going to read is the part about why we don't give up on the church, no matter what messes it makes historically. When I say the church, as I've just explained on the previous page, I don't mean my church, which is the Church of England, and I don't mean any particular named part of the universal church. I mean all of the things which together through Christian history form the church universal. If we waited for the church to clean up, if we waited for the church to be nothing but good, to do nothing but good, we would wait forever. So we don't wait. We don't, in fact, believe the church is precious because it is good, or does good, or because it may do good in future. We care about its behaviour, but we don't believe that its muddled and sometimes awful record is the only truth about it. We believe that the church is precious because it embodies something that sin in general, and our sins of complicity in particular, cannot destroy. Something which already exists now, despite our every failure, and which consequently always has existed for Christians right through all the dark centuries when slavery and tyranny governed the world, and the church too, and the modern idea of rights wasn't even imaginable. When the abbot was a thug who got the abbey from the thug, his brother, who was king, when the bishop did send the boot boys round, when famine raged and the clergy stayed fat, this other thing stayed true, was already true, didn't have to be waited for. For us, you see, the church is not just another institution. It's a failing, but never quite failed, attempt by limited people to perpetuate the unlimited generosity of God in the world. It's built, of all things, on a pun. I said embodies, and the word is exact. The church is a body that wants to be a body. That is, it is a corpus, a corporation, a body of people, in the sense of being a gathered crowd of them, which aspires to be, to carry on from, to keep alive and present and breathing, the literal corporeal body of Jesus, equipped with two arms and two legs and probably the beard and quite possibly the bad teeth in first century Palestine. You do not need to tell us that this is impossible. We know, but we are committed to the impossible anyway, with our ideals of behaviour that only the God of everything can manage, and our efforts to possess a state of being which is only even visible in this world in glimpses, in metaphors, in temporary comparisons. We're used to trying and failing at the impossible, and now and again gaining a piece of the possible we wouldn't have had and wouldn't have known was possible if we hadn't been trying for the impossible. So the church, we say, is the body of Christ. Another comparison with a truth flickering in and out of sight in it. The church is what Christ is doing in the world nowadays. This is not the same thing as saying that the church is magically good no matter what, or that good intentions cancel lousy results. It's not the basis for an excuse, but if anything, for self-accusation. It's a reason for us to be harder on ourselves rather than easier. But it's also a reason for never quite losing hope, never letting go of the conviction that in its stumbling way the church faces towards grace, that it exists like Christ in order to be a channel by which mending enters the world, a mending which, thank God, does not depend on the success of human virtue, individual or collective, but on what breathes and shines through us if we let it. I realise I was advertised as being funny, and there are jokes on other pages.
Well, and I was waiting. I know the passage in the green room, one of the offices over there, we discussed the issue of profanity and whether it was possible. So I was in the middle of what you were saying, I'm waiting for the stink bomb, and it didn't come.
I was going to get to the profanity as well, but
there's still time if you want.
The profanity to which Paul is referring runs like a slightly stinky thread all the way through the book, because one of my problems, I think a general apologetic problem, because this book kind of is apologetics, even though it denies it is on the outside of the box, is that the word sin is deeply misleading. I used the word sin when I was reading that passage, but that's not what it actually says in the book. Because people have this terrible tendency to hear lingerie, whipped cream, chocolate boxes when you say the word sin now. So I invented this completely unpronounceable acronym for sin, the HPTFTU, the human propensity to fuck things up. There you are, you see? Profanity delivered. In the hope that, having charmed people earlier on in the book by my willingness to come to their house and swear at them, that they would then quietly forget what HPTFTU stood for, until all you had was, as it were, a little empty slot on the page, a kind of blank into which meaning could gradually be put, until at the end of the book I am by then able to use the word in all of the useful senses in which we tend to say sin. Problem for this is that HPTFTU is very hard to say aloud, and there is an audiobook version of it. And in the end, I settled on a kind of horrible, phlegmy, throat-clearing noise. The so I've suffered for using. I've suffered for my profanity.
We turn the last page of the book, and then you reveal that it was written at a Costa Coffee in Cambridge, almost the whole thing. That's a English Starbucks, basically, right?
Yep.
And to me, this was astonishing. The book feels so interior, that something that you've worked out so carefully, your mind in conversation and an argument with itself, and the thought that you had sat there with the steaming cappuccino and espresso machines and people on their phones and a Nick Drake album playing.
That's uncanny.
I could hardly figure out how you did it. And it's a very, it feels like a private book, and yet it's the most public of questions, whether Christian religion is legitimate. Yeah. I mean, can you speak a little about that, how private it is and how public?
It's certainly in my setting, it's a public question which can only be addressed through privacy from a private starting point. Public claims in my environment for religion to be treated with respect or attention get nowhere by definition, and they also tend not to provide the motives for individual religious people to be religious. And it seemed to be both truer to religious experience and more rhetorically effective to talk about belief as actually felt. Always happens within a particular life, always happens within the particular story of a life. People don't sin in general, they sin in particular. They don't get redeemed in general, they get redeemed in particular as well. And the thing about storytelling is that human hearts recognize other human hearts. There are common patterns, and people radically removed from each other in terms of sympathy and experience can nevertheless be spoken to by another story. Stories have the power to leap gaps of sympathy, ideology, familiarity. So the story of belief I know best is mine. So it had to have a kind of memoir-y thread running through it. I can I can also dispense with my own privacy without doing anyone but me an injury, so long as I'm quite careful about who else I talk about. And an awful lot of religion is just very, very internal. It happens in your head and your heart. It happens to all external ears in silence in churches. And if you can't describe what's going on there, then people who don't already know what's going on there are going to find it very hard to see or hear anything. So part of what you have to do is find a way to kind of gently turn up the amplification on very quiet, private, intimate experiences so that they can be successfully overheard. You want to turn your reader into a kind of invited eavesdropper.
And how did you figure that out, though? What writers do is put words together in new ways, and I think at the very end of the opening chapter, Unapologetic, you put together words I don't think I had ever seen together, Christian emotions. So this book is about Christian emotions, and yet, you obviously know now the importance of Christian emotions and that's what you'll stake a book on. Mm. But it's a new thing, or it's a rarely done thing. How did you figure that out or find your way to it?
Because every Christian idea has a counterpart in experience. And for that matter, every Christian emotion tends to have a counterpart in theology as well. Christian ideas are not, in fact, abstract ideas. Even Thomas Aquinas thinks that what he's analyzing is the subtle and majestic body of an overwhelming truth, where overwhelming has real weight to it. But there are characteristic Christian emotions. supposing that, for example, you tried to compare them to characteristic Muslim emotions, then you'd have, in the Muslim case, you'd have a set of emotions which had much more to do with social integration of various kinds, which had to do with the satisfying feeling of togetherness and with kind of brother to brother recognition in the mosque. And you'd also have a sense of moral struggle, which was a law-governed moral struggle to it. If you look at the Christian counterparts to those things, to believe that you're part of the body of Christ and that you are not separated from the brothers and sisters around you in the pews, even if you don't like them very much, that's different from feeling buoyed up by a feeling of brotherhood together. Christianity keeps separating love from liking. We can love our enemies. Islam doesn't do love your enemies. It just regards those as being in separate categories. So it seems to me that there is historically a vocabulary of emotion there, and that where it lives is in the life of individual believers, as well as in the systematic patterns that the church, using the church in the kind of big embracing sense again, that the church makes of them. But my attention for this book needed to be all at the small, local, private end, where things get legitimacy by corresponding to people's experience. If Christianity isn't recognizable, then you can't even kind of begin a conversation about it.
And now you have the book, and do you find you still have people who will say, well, Francis, I've read the book. Those aren't my experiences. I still think you're nuts.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And possibly I am nuts. But but in a way, my intentions for it, in Britain anyway, were quite modest. What I wanted was for people's sense of how religious people are nuts to change, to modulate from inexplicably nuts for no good reason at all, to to generously nuts, righteously nuts, nuts in the hope of something which you might want. And one of the nicest things that's been said about the book was a review by Nick Hornby. In fact, in the US, in The Believer, ironically, in which he said, reading this book has not made me a Christian, but it has made me respect people who are Christians more. And that will do nicely. It really will do nicely. One of the ways in which the book really isn't apologetics, as well as, you know, secretly really being apologetics, is that I don't want to convert my readers. I simply want to build a bridge of recognition which people can cross or not as they wish. But I want Christianity to seem less far away and more human normal after people have finished reading it.
Amen to that. So I'm going to turn to David Schickler, and then we'll have questions for both authors in a few minutes. Thank you very much. And they're so, I guess I feel about Nick Hornby, you know, I will never be a fanatical soccer fan, but at least I know what I can understand people who are through his book,
yeah.
And that's the way he feels about yours. So David Schickler, we were just trying to figure out a few minutes ago where we met once, and we don't quite know where.
It was in New York somewhere.
Okay, somewhere in New York. But I went to a Jesuit university and went to Columbia to get an MFA in fiction, and then you went to a Jesuit university and got an MFA in fiction, and you turned out to be a comic writer, and that's what I wanted to be, but I guess there could only be one, so it might as well be you. So I took refuge in nonfiction, thinking that, well, at least I can be a nonfiction writer. And then David had to come out with a nonfiction book that's a comic, but also nonfiction. And the story, for me, is so resonant right to the Billy Bragg and the Alarm and the House Martins and the other guitar bands that, you know, run through the story. It's effortlessly of its moment, but I imagine there's a lot that has to do with this moment in the life of Georgetown too, because it's the same buildings, same care for the person, same preoccupations, and students a generation later. And so it really caught my eye when the book came out. At what point people in the publishing world are phobic about memoirs now? Publishers, to a certain extent, writers. That you have to be apologetic, in a sense, if you've written a memoir, and give an extra justification for why your life is so interesting, or why before you're 80 you get to tell your life story. So at what moment did you just go ahead and say, well, I'm going to do this. It's time to write my own story.
Well, when I first started... sound people tell me, I've been told by a number of people, and a couple of them are here in this audience, former students of mine, that I have too loud of a voice. My 2-year-old daughter, some of her first words were, "Too loud, Daddy, too loud." So please tell me if that's working or not working for you. Yeah, my parents' friends, when I told them I was going to be writing this memoir, you know, their basic take was, you're not Elizabeth Taylor, you're not 75, you haven't slept with a bunch of people in Hollywood, why are you writing a book? And one of the biggest reasons, I'll tell you in a second what the book is about if you don't already know, but one of my takes on memoir, in terms of the contemporary memoir about what's happening, is you get a lot of overly earnest books along the lines of, I have no pancreas, yet I climbed Mount Everest, or something along those lines, where it's very, very earnest all the way through. And I wanted to tell a different story. I wanted to tell a story about my own faith journey, but I wanted to hopefully, I write for television and the movies. I have a show on television called Banshee that's on Cinemax. It's a little edgy and dark and violent, and some of my fiction is that way too. And I see no reason why I can't be that guy and yet still have a practicing faith. But and I wanted to sort of throw those two things together in this book. The Dark Path, for anyone who doesn't know, is the Dark Path is literally a path behind my parents' house when I was growing up. I thought, when I was growing up, when I went to church, I didn't really feel God in church so much. God was a little too shiny bright and perfect and pastel colors at Easter, and that I didn't find that very convincing. Where I found God, where I found Christ and my whole faith really was on this path behind my parents' house in the woods, and I felt closer to God there than I did in church. So that was the literal dark path, and metaphorically the dark path is the path I took toward almost becoming a Jesuit, almost becoming a Catholic priest, and especially during my time here as an undergraduate at Georgetown. And instead, I don't want to give away the ending of the book. It didn't work out. I'm not a priest, as I sit here before you now. I'm a writer of fiction and television and movies. So that's what the book is about. And when I pitched, you know, again, I think there's a lot of overly earnest memoir, because sometimes I understand why those people's, other people's memoirs are so overly earnest, because some of those people, I don't know, were raped and abused horribly when they were children or went through some deeply, deeply scarring experience. I went through a scarring time and a very hard time. I couldn't reconcile my love for women. I grew up in a house full of all girls, three sisters and no brothers, and just girls all over all the time, many of them scantily clad in like dancing outfits because all three of my sisters were dancers. So it was, it wasn't always easy to reconcile my love for women and wanting to sort of date and then find one and have a wife with this very strong pull I felt toward the Catholic priesthood. So I wanted to write about these things, but I saw no reason that they couldn't be, that I couldn't write about it in a funny way. I also know that you asked a simple question, and I have a friend in my hometown who calls me Tangent Man, because sometimes it's hard for me to give a simple answer to a simple question. But I really loved when I read Francis's book. Francis's book, not to be reductive, but one of the things you say, it seems to me, is that the church is a mess. Yeah. But we know it's a mess, and you know it's our mess, and we think it's a mess that has some purposefulness to it. And but when I read about it's a mess, I was just like, oh, I'm a mess. This is a good marriage. This could work. And my book is, you know, you talk about writing about experiencing Christianity from an emotional place, and my book is very messy and sort of, I don't pull any punches about some of the anger that I had and the way that all my ideals of what priesthood was going to be or being a truly good Christian person was going to be. So ask another question now.
Well, instead of asking a question,
okay.
Most of us who are writers collect categories or little ways in which we think of the writer's life, and you added one to my book where late in this book you say that you're a Sunday morning believer, but you're a Saturday night kind of writer, and that brawls and fights and courting and sex and food and all that's what you write about, and that Sunday morning is a different place for you. I don't know how much Saturday night and how much Sunday morning you're going to read, but I hope we get a little of both.
Yeah, well, for me, the I guess what I was trying to say earlier is the idea of when I was young and going to church, and there was a lot of, you know, Easter. We don't see a lot of Easter bonnets anymore, but we used to in the 70s when I was a boy. There's a lot of Easter bonnets, and they were very bright and very pink and very white, and everything just looked sort of just so. And that was sort of, for me, even as a boy, I said, this is weird, this is strange, because this story about this guy, Jesus, he wasn't wearing any bonnets. He didn't seem very shiny or very spiffy. He seemed to sort of, you know, be a guy in the gutter who kicked things over and pissed a lot of people off. And I liked him more than I liked the bonnets. And so I wanted a faith that, unfortunately, one priest, a Jesuit, here at Georgetown that I talked to, you know, he said, he warned me, he said, David, if you go looking for that darker side of God, you might get it. You might find it. I think maybe I did. But in any case, for me, everything that, and by the way, if you haven't read Francis's book, I just read it. Please read his book. His book is so powerful and meant such a great deal to me. I just read it over the course of the past 4 or 5 days. But outside of admitting that, you know, the church or Christianity in general is a mess and always will be and knows that it's a mess, it also sort of says at one point, I have to try to get this right, and you mentioned that we know that we believe in an impossibility, but only in reaching for that impossibility reaching for that impossibility makes our possibilities, the ones that better and greater. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Yeah, I don't know. Shoot for the moon, I guess. But
stop. I'm going to endorse your book as well, because you're using up your own time on my book, which is not fair. There was a great bit at the beginning of David's book. In the east of, you see,
it's like
doubles tennis. This we're kind of, it's the same thing as the Easter bonnet, really. Your childhood objection to the word nifty,
yes,
and the priest who insisted on using the word nifty, leaving you with a kind of a recurrent question about whether you were required to be nifty in order to be a Christian, whether you'd have to sign up to a world of nothing but Easter bonnets and Sunday mornings and would have to forego the Saturday nights. I really like the way that this book makes the combination of both real and does justice to the untidiness of life and to the place faith can still have within an untidy life.
Okay, well, can I read a little bit?
Please,
since
do.
I'm yammering and getting off topic. Okay, so I thought I was going to be a Jesuit priest. I came here to Georgetown. I didn't tell, the only people I told that I was going to be a Jesuit priest or wanted to be one were other Jesuit priests here. Then I fell in love when I was a sophomore at Georgetown with a young woman named Mara. It's not a real name. The legal department of Riverhead and I went back and forth for a long time, and you know, she now reads like a character from, you know, the moon or Mars or Venus instead of a girl from Long Island or what? New England, let's call it. In any case, my book, to a certain extent, is a love triangle between me and God and this woman. And it's a lot about the struggle between faith and art, because I truly thought that, and I know there's a lot of people out there, maybe there are some, you know, here who just like, just be a Protestant, dude. It would have been so much easier. He could have gotten married. Everything would have been smooth. But that's not the club I grew up in, so I may have had a fair amount of baggage, and now you get to hear a little bit about it. So my sophomore year at Georgetown, I met and fell in love with a woman, and I was trying to reconcile my path toward priesthood, which I was very devoted to the fact that I really loved this girl and couldn't stay away from her. So I'll read a quick part set here at Georgetown, and then a little part from later on. Okay. I'm out with my friend Mason at a bar called The Tombs in Georgetown. We're having mugs of Rolling Rock, and I'm thinking to myself, David, stop thinking about her. Stop thinking about Mara. You're on a path toward solitude, toward God, toward priesthood. You don't need distraction from that. But then Mason and I split another pitcher and a half of Sam Adams, and it's 2 in the morning. And then I'm weaving alone down the O Street sidewalk, or sidewalks, since there appear to be 3 of them. When I get to Mara's row house, her front door, I'm just trying to pass by, but I see that her front door has been blown open by wind, which she told me happens sometimes. I chivalrously step inside and close the door behind me. Because what if some drunk guy saw it open and just wandered in? Hello? I call. There's no answer. This saddens me. I miss Mara. I have to tell her something vital, though I can't recall what. I decide to go upstairs to her bedroom and tell it to her. I fumble up the stairs and pause on the landing. There's one bedroom on the left and another on the right. I enter the latter, knowing that the top bunk in the far right corner holds Mara. I stand squinting in the dark at her bed, trying to make out her shape, or the shape of her stuffed animal toucan, Gabriel Puffalump. Her upper bunk looks higher than it did the last time I was in this room. I cross the room and start climbing up to her. There are dresses and coat hangers in my way as I climb. I swat them aside. The hangers clatter. A female voice gasps in the dark below. Oh my God, who's there? I arrive on Mara's bunk. She's not there, and neither is Gabriel Puffalump. Instead, there are textbooks and women's hats. In a rush, I throw these off the bunk, worried that Mara is somehow trapped beneath them. The textbooks slap the floor below. What the hell? Cries the same female voice. The voice isn't Mara's. Who's there? Where's Mara? I finish clearing books off and I lie down and close my eyes. The bunk feels hard, like a plain wooden slat. It seems thinner across than it should be, and there's no mattress, no blankets, no comfort. Mara! I wail. Wait, Dave? The female voice turns accusatory. Dave Schickler? Mara's not here. I moan. Of course she isn't, you freaking idiot. You're on the top shelf of my closet. The slat gives way under me. I fall through clothes hangers 8 feet and hit the floor. Lights come on. I'm at the feet of Mara's housemate, Melanie. She's standing in a long green nightshirt with her hands in her hips. There are textbooks and women's hats everywhere. You're in the wrong room, and you just scaled my closet. Are you on drugs? Mara comes in from the hall, from the direction of her bedroom, the one I thought I'd entered. She looks sleepy and beautiful. Dave? My back is killing me. The next day, Melanie tells the whole campus about my closet climbing, and I get mercilessly mocked. I vow to straighten up and fly right and be the kind of college student my father was. I try to put Mara from my mind, to crack down, to stay on the path. So that's a little Georgetown section where I was still trying to hold very true and dear to my ideals. And then it didn't work out so well. We eventually broke up, although it was mutual, but it may have been a little more mutual on her part than it was on mine. In any case, I ended up without the girl, and I went on to get a Master's of Fine Arts in Creative Writing at Columbia, but the whole time I was moving closer, still talking about joining the priesthood. Then I finally realized years later that it was never going to happen for me, and I went through a very profound depression and a loss of faith and a karate injury to my hip where I was sort of dragging my ass around upstate Vermont, where I was supposed to be teaching in a boarding school, but I had insomnia and I was on medication and I was drinking too much. It's a really upbeat story. You gotta check it out. But in the meantime, I realized I was still in love with this girl, that with Mara, and I sort of, you know, went and found her. She was going to be marrying another guy, and I went and sort of tried to stop her at the altar and profess my love. I spilled my guts to her in a Pizzeria Uno in Boston, and she said that she'd been thinking about me a lot lately, too. Uh-oh. Yeah, so read the book, buy the book to find out how it all turns out. But I also, when I was up in Vermont, there was a lake that I would go to on the northern border of Vermont and Canada. There was this sort of frozen lake, and I would drive up there at like 2 or 3 in the morning because I had insomnia, and I would show up looking like crap at 7 in the morning to teach young kids English at this boarding school. But I wasn't currently believing in God at the time, but there was, so I referred to whatever was out there as lack of God. And this is just a little example of the kind of rant that would come into my head. I think it's very important to be honest about the experiences you go through. A lot of people seem to think that not only is God nifty in Christians' conception, but our treatment of him or the way we speak to him might be this like neat packaged thing. This is something I need, please give it to me. This is how I feel, please give it to me. I've had a much more raw experience than that. I don't know if that tracks with other people, but that's how this felt. So this was a little angry, this part. Sorry. Lack of God. Do you want to know what's bullshit? I will tell you what's bullshit. It's bullshit that priests always told me that celibate priesthood is something higher. Even St. Paul said it. He said he wished we could all be like him, unencumbered, set aside for the work of the Spirit. So what? That means the rest of us who aren't called to priesthood, we're called to something lower? We're encumbered? St. Paul said if we're not strong enough for celibacy, we should marry. He said there's no sin in it. Well, whoop-dee-fucking-do. What an exciting reason to be with someone forever, because there's no sin in it. Is that the big selling point, that getting hitched and being with my wife and honoring her and loving her won't send me straight to hell? Are you getting this, lack of God? Are you getting why my heart and mind and body and soul are exhausted from running through this again and again? If St. Paul's right, and the solitary, unencumbered path is the most blessed one, then the system's rigged. Either I'm strong and celibate, and I devote my life to you as a priest, and I go where the wind of the Spirit pushes me in service of you, and I live as St. Paul wishes me to. Or else, I'm weak, and I succumb to the callings of the flesh, and I choose married life, but at least there's no sin in it. Bullshit ultimatum. That's a loaded coin flip where only one side of the coin looks shiny. How can that be the whole story? Why does your book wax so poetic about the magic of priests and of solitary, miracle-working prophets, and leave out so much about the magic of men and women together? Where in your book is a man like my father giving out groans while he hugs his wife hello each night when he comes home from work? And where in your book is a girl like Mara, scarred and gorgeous, her eyes full of secret green fire? Don't say the Song of Songs. That's 20 pages. That's all the lovers get, a footnote. The rest of your book, the stuff about priests and prophets and their lonely male work, is thousands of pages. Is that what I am to you now, lack of God, now that I want Mara back? Am I a footnote, a small thing who can't wield power, a commoner waiting for some bishop's blessing rather than giving to a woman or receiving from her a blessing of my own? Mara is not a small thing. My love for her is not small, and it's not something lower. So why'd you write a book and build a church that are making me feel tonight so small and low and second class compared to priests, to the kind of man that I can never be? Are you listening? I've listened for years. Now you fucking listen. Sorry. That's how it felt, anyway, at the time.
The anger feels real. It feels real
just,
now.
I'm just trying to bring it to life.
Well, you're good at it. These books were made such a strong impression when I read them, and to have the two of you here animating them, it's really something. But I've said enough. Let's hear from people in the room. Are there questions for Francis or David about their books or about the mysteries of the universe?
Please ask questions. We love them, right, Francis? We love them. And also, this is something that's important for me to say. I don't know if this tracks for you. I think it does. But I didn't write my book for Catholics. You know, I don't know how this happened. My wife is Protestant. All my best friends are Protestants and Jews and atheists. And this is a coming of age story that takes place between mostly when I was 18 to 25. A lot of it takes place here at Georgetown. I remain a practicing Catholic. I have a lot of problems with the papacy or with the church, with the mess that, you know, Christianity continues to be. But, you know, my book, in case you were ever thinking of reading it, if you're not somebody who's, if you're a former Catholic, recovering Catholic, whatever you might be, or somebody from a completely different faith system, I still think, I didn't write the book. I feel like a pretty ragged believer a lot of the time, and the book is not a record of theological points. So it comes from a very experiential place, and I think that Francis's does too.
It does.
Just wanted to throw that out there. Now, does anybody have any questions?
Now we've subtly shaped the mind that you might ask us.
Oh, she doesn't need a microphone.
This question is for David. Your past work was fiction, short stories. Can you talk a little bit about how this is obviously near, dear to your heart? There's still some anger. Was it because this was something that you were still, I haven't read it yet, so is this something that you were still working through that you wanted to get down on paper and that was kind of a release for you, or?
That's a good question. Despite the reading, by the way, I've never read that little section when I was up at that lake in Vermont, and I'm not really still angry. I'm especially because I probably would be if I'd been a priest, but I'm not. You know, I'm married to a beautiful, wonderful woman who's absolutely the person for me and the right vocation for me, as is writing. So I only read it angry because it felt angry at the time. But something that's very important for me, and I don't know how this tracks for you writing this book. I didn't write this book when you we talked about working through things. I didn't write this book as therapy, and that's a really important point to me. There are some people I know that journal and that do write therapeutically. And my advice to you, if you write therapeutically, that's great, but don't ever publish therapeutically. If you publish a piece of writing that you wrote as therapy, then any criticism that somebody might have of it, you're going to take it personally, and it's going to be awful. I really write, honestly, for one reason, to entertain myself and other people, to try to crack myself up or break my own heart or make other people laugh or to break their hearts a little bit too. So I tried to write this as novelistically as I could, even though it just struck me as a good story that I just sat down and said, "Self, you're a great story." No. It just seemed to me there were some people, you know, at the when I was going through some of this stuff, a couple of them are in this room right now that were roommates of mine at Georgetown. Who said, "You got some issues, don't you?" and you know, a few years ago, I said, "Yeah, I do. Maybe I'll write about some of those issues." But I like to write stories that have where the stakes are very high. In my fiction, I like to write stories where life and death is on the line, or bodies and souls are on the line. And that's how I felt in my own life at the time. A lot of this was internal. You talked about how internal religion is. And so, like, that rant at the lake, you know, there's nobody else, a passing duck, maybe, but there was no one else up there to be like, "Ooh, he's really going through something." So it was a lot of it was interior monologue, but it felt very dire to me, and I like to write stories about dire stuff. So I considered it sort of all of a piece with the way I write fiction. But I did try to write it very, very novelistically. Also, I have met a lot of like freaky, wonderfully freaky and weird people in my life. And a lot of them I met between when I was like 18 and 25 or 18 and 30. And I just tried to pack as many of them as I could into the book because I missed them. And they helped me get through this hard time. That was, again, a long answer to a short question, sorry.
And just to be clear, I was commending your anger. I guess what struck me, I read these books and then wrote the descriptive text for this evening and then reread the books, and to be...
Oh my God.
To be...
impressive.
Well, just to read them a second time is to see what a range of emotions both of you work through. I mean, there's college comedy in your book, and then there's... the anger of a man shaking his fist at not God or lack of God. And you've got an account of the humanity of Jesus, but also of the crazy embarrassment that Christians feel and the winking superiority of the Richard Dawkins and Christopher Hitchens of the world. And I mean, I guess that it's...
Can I have
that,
guilt as well?
Yes, tell us about your guilt.
Not directly, but I feel that as a Protestant of an Episcopalian kind, I have to insist here that our kind of guilt can be as dark, clogged, and hard to handle as Catholic as Catholic guilt.
My best friend, who's an evangelical Protestant, he's like, "I'm tired of this Catholic guilt crap." He's like, "Mine's just as bad as yours."
Yeah.
It's kind of like Starbucks, where they have just different varieties of, you know, dark roast and medium roast and Supremo, different kinds of Christian guilt, I guess. Let's have another question. I'm going to call on one of my students if I don't have a question. So. Yes, in the back.
Hi. Hi, this question is also for David. The Dark Path is largely about breaking down religious paradigms, standard ones, and sort of breaking unconventional rules in order to still find your version of holiness. But yet you still adhere to some of them, mostly premarital sex. What made you, or at what point did you decide, okay, I want to follow this Catholic rule, but not the others?
At what point, the thing that, why am I still Catholic? Because first of all, I don't really think about premarital sex too much more anymore. I'm more into the marital sex now because I'm married and have been for quite some time. But when I came back to, when I sort of stopped going to church for quite some time, when I came back to Catholicism, the reason I came back to Catholicism in particular, I think, and this isn't a very popular thing to say, especially when you know, look, I write in Hollywood. I don't talk to anybody about any of this stuff very frequently. I'm going to answer your question, but first I want to say that one of the greatest things, and I think this is the case with maybe why Francis wrote his book, and it's certainly why I wrote my book, Francis has a wonderful refrain. He boils the words of Christ down to a wonderful refrain of a few certain sentences. And one of them, he says that Jesus is telling us, especially about the way we love one another, don't be careful. Don't be careful. Don't be careful about the way you love other people. Don't do it in just right according to certain laws and certain strictures. Do it too much. Do it to the much, you know, don't plan for the morrow. Sort of give more of yourself away than you should. Do it really, really generously. Do it impossibly. And I guess I tried to follow that advice, don't be careful in writing the book, because at least that's what Dad says. Yeah, you certainly weren't careful, David. Thank you for putting so much about me in there, son. I waited until the night before the book came out to have him read it, and I was sort of on tenterhooks. My dad was on a path toward becoming a Catholic deacon at the same time as I was approaching the Catholic priesthood, so there's sort of this dual arc of the two of us in the book, and it didn't work out for him either, incidentally. Although he doesn't write, violent, sexed up things for television. He's just a nice engineer guy. The impossibility of the Catholic sacraments, particularly of the Eucharist, is why I came back. The Eucharist is why I go. This is not a popular thing to say or believe. I actually really believe it. And it's, I don't know what else to say. I mean, there are other points, but uniquely compared to, I guess there are some, you could speak to this more about what your experience is of the, I don't know that much. Are you Episcopalian or Anglican?
I'm an Anglican. But
Anglican.
It's the same thing.
But of what your experience, I know that some Protestants believe, I hate the word transubstantiation because it sounds like Transformers, something that's happening in like my son's comic books. But in any case, everything else aside, that's the thing that means, Mass itself is what brought me back. We can talk one-on-one after if I didn't give you any kind of enough of an answer. Sorry, I'm really not trying to dodge.
One of the difficulties of writing my book is that I had to both make it clear that I'm speaking from one particular little place on the Christian map, and also to describe the whole damn thing so that other kinds of Christians would at least consent to be recognized. And straight after the bit I read before is the bit about the Eucharist, which is central to me as well. And I do believe in the real presence, but opinions vary in my church. We're confused like that. But this was kind of useful because I had to write a short description of what on earth we say is going on, which could be recognized by a kind of upright Presbyterian and by a Catholic at the same time. And what I've got is this. And then for us, the bread made unmysteriously from wheat and the wine made unmysteriously from grapes are different. There has been a change in their meaning. For some of us, the material bread and material wine have altered on a tiny domestic scale with crumbs and dregs and washing up in the same way that the material world was altered by having its creator within it. Right there on the table, the set of the world once more contains itself as a member. Once more, a peculiar knot has been tied in the fabric of existence. And for others of us, the change in meaning is made by the material world aligning itself to form a sign of what began happening once in Jerusalem long ago, and, the sign reminds us, is still happening now. Either way, the change puts the same strange burden on our imagination. We're eating God.
It's a really, you call it out, you use a word that I'm very, he uses the word cannibalism in his book. My best friend from Georgetown, who's referred to as Mason in the book, who's going all around Los Angeles, he waited till he read it, now he's proud of it, and going around and telling his friends, I'm Mason in the book. But he used to hop up and down on our couch here at Georgetown. He's like, you're a motherfucking cannibal, shit. You're a cannibal, because of what I felt about the Eucharist. And he called me a cannibal every day. I would walk in the door, he's like, hey, cannibal, when I would walk in the door. So. A lot of people are offended by the idea of cannibalism, and I think there's still a lot of people in the world who are offended by the idea of some real presence of God in that bread. I think it's cool. I'm offended. I think it's offensive too, but I'm attracted to offensive and out there things, so it's just impossible enough for me to stay on board with it. Come on, somebody else ask a question. We came all this way.
I have a question.
Okay.
Hi, Dave. It's Lindsay from Columbia.
Lindsay.
I had no idea you had so many issues, but that's probably just because I was a bad friend. But yeah, I knew David when he was at Columbia, but this is a question actually for both Francis and David. So my mom's Jewish, my dad's Catholic, so I grew up, you know, feeling guilty that I was even alive. But also grew up feeling like we didn't have a spiritual center in the house because there was a snobbery on both sides, you know, the sort of Jewish take that we are the chosen people, and then the kind of Catholic take that our way is the right way, and there wasn't a questioning there. And yet I'm intrigued by both religions, and it frustrates me that if you're not aligned with one particular religion, you are considered a person who is not of faith. And so I'm just kind of curious about your take on that, that if you're not part of an organized religion, can you still be a person of faith? Because I always feel like I'm viewed as someone who doesn't have faith when I do.
I think I am in no position to tell anybody, you know, the people whose opinions I respect the most are generally, my book is an attempt to sort of say what a humble place I remain in because of, you know, I kind of got my ass kicked in this book by my trying to apprehend what my relationship, you know, with God was. And anybody from any religion who speaks, I mean, to even be a religion, you have to sort of say, these are the things that we sort of all hold in common. These are the things that we follow, or at least try to follow. But I personally, for such a long time, was a person who, despite having grown up devoutly Catholic and having, I'll put it this way, I try to explore exactly what you're talking about in most of my fiction and even in the movies and television episodes I write because I'm fascinated by it. I feel exactly what you're talking about all the time and experience that myself for many, many years. My co-creator of the show Banshee is an Orthodox Jew. And, you know, I went to my first bar mitzvah for his son and know way more about Judaism than I ever did. And I, you know, I have tremendous, you know, he thinks I'm nuts for some of the things that I follow. But I don't know. I guess there are two things about that for me. One, don't kill the other guy who doesn't agree with you. That's the big one. And the other one is the snobbery that you're talking about. And that was when, for example, I'll just pull it away from religion for a second. When I was at Georgetown, when I was here as an undergraduate, even though I was far more politically conservative than I am now. And by the way, it pains me what Christianity has become in the public forum in the United States, the way that it's attached to the right or to the Republican Party in a way that is that's not me, that's not my faith experience. You know, it's the fact that I voted for Obama twice should tell the Republican Party, like, they lost me, they lost the war. Because I know I'm taking a long time to answer your question, but when I went to Georgetown, when I was here, people, no matter what you believed politically, there seemed to be discussion about it. When I got to New York, where I was in school with you at Columbia, Lindsay and I both went to the Columbia MFA writing program, nobody talked at all about political stuff. Everyone just assumed that you 1,000% were full on liberal and believed exactly what they believed. And if I had said anything to the contrary, now the fact that I've come a lot further toward that particular place personally, I don't know, whatever, says something about life, but I would have been shouted down or sort of, at least I felt like I would have been, and that was a horrible place, and that felt like a place of snobbery. So anytime anybody from any religious standpoint is coming at it from a snobby, I absolutely know, and you absolutely do not, all I can say is that's painful for me too, and that's hard for me too, still every day. I have a sister who I love very dearly, and sometimes she says things where I have to kind of say, no, that's not me, and that's not what I believe, and sorry, you go now.
That's okay. I think that energy that goes into policing the boundaries between religions is usually wasted energy, and is usually easier for people in a not very attractive way than practicing whatever's supposed to be at the middle of each of the religions. Having said that, the differences are important too, and it seems to me that the basis for mutual respect, especially given the vexed and sometimes tragically awful history of the relations between Christianity and Judaism, that the basis for respect is to be straightforward and honest about the differences. Christianity says that Judaism is incomplete. And Judaism thinks that Christianity, when it's not being tactful and polite about it, is a kind of wacky cult version of Judaism. Fair enough. That doesn't stop a conversation. That only allows one to begin without people being all kind of edgy and defensive about it. And given that what they have in common is God, who fills all voids and supplies all deficiencies, ultimately we shouldn't actually worry that much about our notoriously inadequate ways of thinking about him from our end. One of the things that really pisses me off about new atheists is that they think they have this kind of unbelievably, comprehensively, irrefutably successful takedown argument when they go kind of, so you think your religion's true, right? And you go, yeah. And they go, then why is there like more than one religion? You know, because we're humans, because we operate in a state of uncertainty, because we make generous estimates of what the world means based on where we are. The nice thing about monotheism is that there is God at the other end of the string pulling. And ultimately, we don't have to get it perfectly right. So no, don't have any trouble at all with spirituality, which washes untidily over boundaries.
And the last thing I'll say to your question is, again, we're here talking about our books, but this television show that I created with this friend of mine. You know, it's a show about a criminal who's pretending to be a cop in a small town in Pennsylvania called Banshee. But we both came from, you know, not just two religious traditions, but really, you know, really, really quite religious homes growing up. And we both, you know, we're in a different, you know, I don't know that we follow the complete exact letter of the law of our religions the way we grew up, but I know this, when we spend time together and when we tell stories together and when we keep a sense of humor about all of it, which is technically one of the things that brought us together, because Francis has a great sense of humor in his book. I try to have a sense of humor about some of the stuff that I do. Really good, for story purposes anyway, really good, rich stuff comes out of it. Great comedy and pathos. And for me, I don't know. Maybe that's enough, or at least that's a great deal. It gives me a little bit of a job because, anyway, I love it. And I don't run from the differences. I like to stay right in the middle of them. And
they're also what generate drama.
They're what generate drama. Someone over there had a question.
Hi, good afternoon. So I have two questions, actually, one for Francis and one for David. So I'm just going to speak the two of them. So my question for Francis is, the name of the book, it's Unapologetic. And while you were talking, I was thinking of all the things that Christianity and religious culture actually has to apologize for. And it is no coincidence that John Paul II apologized to the whole world for the Inquisition and the wars. But at the same time, looking at my own personal experience of this apologetic approach to that history, it's that sometimes people start stepping on that humbleness and they want you to be on your knees forever, right? So I was mean, I already apologized, let's move on. But it seems that society has not yet achieved that. So how can we find a balance between being humble and apologizing for our mistakes, but at the same time keeping our head up and being proud of who we are and of what we've done right? And then my question for David is that when you were mentioning this second class of sacraments between marriage and priesthood, it came to my mind the idea that there's actually also a third class, which is the people that don't even have the right for that sacrament. So speaking about two examples of that would be same-sex couples and also people who has divorced and have fallen in love again. So what would your comments be on those examples of people falling in love and not being recognized in their way to sanctity?
Well, at least it's not a big question.
Hey, mine's quite big, too.
Yeah, you go first, man.
How much apology is too much apology, and when should you stop? The thing about real apologies is that they are kind of open-ended. You can't require other people to forgive you, and you're kind of on their timetable for when the forgiveness happens. So if there's a historic wrong you'd like to apologize for, and there's a kind of, this is a bit of a contemporary cultural ritual, some historic wrongs you just think, how is it being made better by having this completely detached present day representative of it saying sorry? For example, the British government apologized for the terrible time that they gave Alan Turing in 1947 recently. And I just think, that was other people. I don't even see the moral thread connecting you with the original wrong there. That is the kind of symbolism that brings symbolism into ill repute. On the other hand, where there is a real thing to be sorry for, where there is something in the Christian record, like, for example, Christian anti-Semitism, or nearer our own time, the things to do with clergy child abuse or whatever, to mean sorry is to throw it open and just to wait on somebody else's pleasure for them to decide that you've been sorry enough. You can't move on from that without trying to force on the other party a sense that their injury really wasn't very great at all. Then, though, there's the issue of how easy it is to be trodden on if you're down there on your knees. Your head is lower than the crowd. It's easy to overlook that you're there at all. And I think you end up with a paradox, basically. You have to be assertive about being humble. You have to be absolutely clear and unignorable about the fact that you are in a kind of an open posture of penitence. It sounds like a contradiction, but Christianity contains many contradictions, and I suspect that the church fathers putting together the whole thing in the first place were really quite familiar with the need to go, we are definitely humble people who rely on the grace of God, and we don't care who knows it. And it is possible to be unapologetically apologetic.
I also think to that, you know, like I was in a romantic relationship, just to speak to his point, I was in a romantic relationship once where, I mean, I don't even think it has to be about religious stuff. There's this person that I went out with once, you know, sorry was never enough. I could never be sorry enough for this person when I had screwed up, and she would bring something back, and I was a pretty good guy. I don't know if it was like, it wasn't even that big of a, it's not like I slept with somebody else or anything. I don't remember, but I never really felt forgiven for certain things. And it depends on the person you're talking to or who is lobbying that accusation against you. But I think you come to find out just experientially in life that even if it's not religion, you get a sense of certain people who are never going to forgive you, or who are never going, no sorry is ever going to be enough. And deep down, maybe they don't want to, or maybe that they enjoy. I'm not trying to write those people off, but I've had a couple people in my life where I've had to part company with that person, or I just have to not keep on talking to that person on a regular basis, because whatever it was that I did, that I really was as sorry, you know, I can't give you the script of my soul any more openly than I have, but there were things that I was sorry for that I sort of couldn't keep on apologizing for. So, I mean, I do think sometimes you hit a point in conversation with some people where you're like, I think it's best if we just don't talk about this a lot anymore. So that's come up for me. You asked a couple of really big doozy questions. People who are divorced and who want to come take the Eucharist, you're talking about? Was that one of your questions? And then what do I think about same-sex couples and whether they should be allowed to be married in the Catholic Church? Is that part of your question?
Not specifically if you think they should be allowed to get married or if you think they should be given the Eucharist. But if you think that just as how you felt as a second class part of the story of God's salvation and that your vocation to marriage was some sort of a second class vocation, do you think that it is possible that right now there are other people, like divorced people who are in love with someone else and want to get married again, or same-sex couples, is it possible that they might be feeling or that they might be representing right now because of the structure of our church?
It's not just possible, it's absolutely 1,000% the case. I mean, my best friend is my best friend is a non-practicing gay man who grew up Catholic, who has never been in a physical relationship with another man. And loathes this and rolls up in a ball and cries himself to sleep every night. And if my church doesn't speak to that person and talk to that person very directly into the place and the experience that they're in, then my church sucks. You know, that person needs, and he doesn't need to be told you can be fixed or, you know, any of this crap. And it's my best friend and I love him to pieces. And so, you know, and it's his own decision not to be, you know, he's no longer Catholic. He became Episcopal because of the Catholic Church's, I think the most important thing for me, the most important thing is the tone with, and this has to do with the snobbery that you were talking about, Lindsay, like the tone with which you just deal with people on a person to, at least in my experience, on a person-to-person basis with whatever it might be talking about. But yes, I think it's a, I think he probably feels, mostly he just feels really effing lonely and doesn't know quite what to do about it because he doesn't feel that he should be with another man. But, you know, so, and about divorced people that want to marry somebody else. My own sister is twice divorced, and I think the first time she got an annulment, I'm not sure if there's a second annulment, you know, in the offing. That's a tough one. The one thing I will say about the, I know very little about the process of getting an annulment. My experience from the outside looking in is that it's probably a big drag and takes a really long time. But I will say one thing about the Catholic Church that I think that they do get right, which is the wedding preparation stuff, pre-cana, whatever you want to call it. Pre-cana, there's another word. Anyway, you have to go away for a weekend or you have to take this series of classes, and yeah, you roll their eyes and they're a drag. My wife's Protestant, my wife's not Catholic. But they ask, you know, we were forced to ask each other a lot of fascinating questions, and one of the big points of the weekend that I was stunned by, I hope this doesn't sound like I'm getting off topic, but they said, you know, a lot of people think that different attitudes about sex are what going to be what split people up, and almost always, far more often, it's money, different attitudes about money. One person thinking, if you loved me, you would save, and the other person deep down thinks, if you loved me, you would spend. And they made us talk about these things in a very bold-faced way, and I thought that was really great. And I sort of felt like if, I'm not sure the Catholic Church has all the answers, but there are some people who get married without, and those are just two topics I just mentioned briefly, money and sex, who get married without getting into the nitty-gritty of those kinds of things. And my sister, for example, I know, like her best friend got married. Anyway, I think that kind of stuff can be good, if that makes any sense. And now I've yammered on for too long, so I'm sorry.
I was just thinking that if I were running the pre-cana process, I would have people read your books because they'd go down the dark path and they'd learn how to be unapologetically apologetic, and those marriages would last. This has been fantastic. You want one more question? I would like to break and have you talk to the authors individually, I think.
I want to hear this guy's question. He's got one.
Okay, but then we got chance for you all to sign some books and talk to people one-on-one.
And also, please, I don't know if this goes for you, Francis, but I really, like, I was talking to this author the other day. He's like, don't you just hate going out on the road and book tour and, like, meeting people? I was just like, are you effing nuts? No, I love it. It's like if you sit in a room by yourself for, like, 4 or 5 years and work on this kind of thing. And so all I'm trying to say is, you know, on the back of my book, there's my website and my Twitter, and I really like talking to people. So if we don't talk tonight, please be in touch and reach out. I really like doing that sort of stuff. What's your question, sir?
this is, I guess, really with the students in the room in mind, but besides advice about avoiding closets at all cost, do you have any advice for Georgetown students or any university student who's naturally going through their own period of reflection about their faith and their life and these big questions you wrestled with, and sort of, is there one or two big lessons that you took away from that period of struggle at Georgetown?
Wow. My biggest problem was I kept so much of this stuff bottled up inside, and I talked to a couple priests. Hey, my cousin's here. I talked to a couple priests, but I didn't talk to, I was too afraid to talk about a lot of this stuff with other people, and I waited a really long time. And in my experience in dating was sort of the same way if I dated somebody when I was 18 or when I was 22. For example, this girl, Mara, I never told her the truth about me and what I was going through until I broke down and was 24 and went and found her in that Pizzeria Uno and then just dumped it all in like 37 minutes. And she's like, what the? But she knew, she had always known that there was something going on. And so I think like in young romantic relationships, you wait a really long time, sometimes 2 or 2.5 years to get to the point where you are really talking about the deep down stuff with the other person. And my advice to young people is try not to do that. Try not to wait. You know, if you have big questions, find somebody who maybe isn't going to bounce up and down on a couch and call you a cannibal every other 30 seconds. But find somebody also who is who's not just going to be a yes man for you and say, you know what, you're absolutely right. Like, where you come from and your traditions, all of that is exactly right. Like, it's great to have somebody who will push back. I don't know. I just sort of feel like the more emotionally honest, like Francis's book is so just, it's just so spot on honest. It's just honest, honest, honest. This is exactly how I feel. And I feel like, I took a long time to get to that place, and maybe all of us do, but if there are Georgetown undergraduates who, I don't know what these faith questions
don't
might.
Wait until it's time to write your memoir.
Yeah, don't wait until then.
To be honest.
Wait until then. Try and be brave.
Don't
be
careful.
Don't
reveal your secrets in your middle 40s. tell them early.
As Francis said, you know, Christ's basic advice seemed to be, don't be careful. Don't be too careful. I don't know if that's a good enough answer, but that's one of the ones I would give. And also thank everybody so much for coming.
Yes, thank you very much. Thanks to both of you, and you'll be signing your books and greeting people individually, and we'll do this again, I hope. Thank you.